So, all right. Well, so thanks so much for the introduction, especially for pushing my book. It's great to be here. I guess my first time in Indiana. So, so my goal is to just give you a general introduction to quantum computing and information from my personal perspective, and hopefully give you plenty of chance to ask questions about it. Okay, so, because you know, I'll assume that you've heard something about quantum computing, but you know, it's in the news a lot. But what gets sort of filtered out, you know, unfortunately, I think tends to be sort of one of two types of perspectives. The first is that quantum computing is coming, and you know, in maybe 5 years, or maybe it's even already here, and furthermore, it's going to, you know, completely transform, you know, all of information technology, you know, more, you know, as much or more than the transistor itself, and, you know, unlike a classical computer that can only do things one by one, you know, a quantum computer can somehow just do everything in parallel, you know, explore all the possible answers and instantly pick out the best one. And, you know, and this is, you know, I guess, you know, coming to a store near you in, you know, in a few years. Okay, the second type of perspective says, well, you know, that's just sounds too good to be true, and you know, it's already, people have been talking about this for 20 years already, so where are they yet, right? And so you know, quantum computing is probably just some science fiction fantasy, or maybe even a hoax or a fraud, and you know, there must be, you know, in fact, something simple that all these physicists have been overlooking that would just explain why it's not possible at all. So my own opinion is that sort of neither of those two viewpoints are correct. Regarding the when we're going to have quantum computers, you know, I mean, what I like to point out is that you know, it was 130 years between Charles Babbage, you know, thinking about his analytical engine, and the invention of the transistor, right? It was centuries between, you know, when people first started thinking about, you know, heavier than air flight, you know, and actually giving correct physical arguments for why it should be possible, you know, and the Wright brothers. Okay, so, you know, we have plenty of precedent that, you know, people can realize, you know, something looks compatible with the laws of physics, but, you know, the technology just may not be there, right? And so, you know, on the type of time scale that I think, you know, we should really be paying attention to, 20 years is not even that long. You know, there has been, you know, fantastic progress that experimentalists have made, you know, over the last 20 years, and, you know, how to control individual quantum systems, how to sort of demonstrate, you know, some of like the basic building blocks that would be needed for a quantum computer. So some of you might know that just this past year, a Nobel Prize in Physics was awarded to David Wineland, basically for, you know, demonstrating the building blocks of quantum computing in ion trap systems. Now, you know, in terms of what has sort of demonstrably, you know, been built and sort of demonstrably been a quantum computer, or, you know, used a quantum algorithm. Well, so quantum computers, you know, after, you know, all the, you know, hundreds or thousands, really, of talented people working in this field for several decades, quantum computers have been used to factor 15 into 3 × 5 with high probability. That was the record for a while. I'm pleased to say that just a year ago, paper was published using photonics to actually improve that. They've now factored 21 into 3 × 7. Okay, so it's clear that, you know, we're a long way from, let's say, factoring the 10,000 digit numbers that you know, or threatening. using like the cryptography that we use on the internet. You know, and I'll be happy to go into the reasons later why sort of scaling this up is such a difficult engineering challenge. But on the other hand, you know, from everything that we know about the laws of physics, it really, really, you know, looks like, you know, it ought to be merely an engineering problem. You know, the way that I like to put it is that, you know, if quantum computing is not possible, that, you know, meaning, you know, not just really, really hard, but, you know, really fundamentally, you know, in principle impossible, then we really, really don't understand quantum mechanics itself. Okay, either quantum mechanics, you know, is wrong and has to be overthrown, you know, by some new framework for physics, or, you know, there's some radical new principle on top of quantum mechanics that would, you know, prevent a quantum computer from ever working. Either way, you know, my perspective is, you know, wow, I hope that that, you know, will happen. That would be way more exciting even than building a quantum computer, you know, to discover that it can't work for, you know, such a profound reason, right? So, you know, to me, that would be an even better outcome. So either way, you know, I hope that we'll learn, you know, the truth. And, you know, I tend to think that probably quantum computers will someday be possible, just because that's the more conservative option, right? That's sort of the more boring option, if you like, from a physics standpoint. But this is fundamental science. You know, people are trying to do something new, and, you know, trying to sort of test quantum mechanics in, maybe the most stringent way it's ever been tested. And so, you know, we hope that we'll learn something new. Okay, let me just ask, can you raise your hand if you've heard of D-Wave? All right, good. That's, you know, maybe half of you. So a lot of the sort of misleading press, I would say, about quantum computing, you know, over the last decade, has been driven by, you know, this company in Vancouver called D-Wave, which is claiming to have practical quantum computers already. So just a couple weeks ago, you may have read, you know, in the news, they sold one of their devices to a consortium of Google and NASA for $15 million. Previously, they'd sold one to Lockheed Martin for $10 million. The big question that sort of most of us have been trying to figure out is, what exactly are these devices? So they're literally giant black boxes. I visited their headquarters in Vancouver. I've walked inside their black boxes, you know, most of which is a cooling system. In the middle, there's a little superconducting Josephson junction chip where they try to use an approach called quantum annealing to try to get sort of pretty good solutions to combinatorial optimization problems. You know, and they don't claim that it will always work, but, you know, they hope that by using quantum effects that they'll get some advantage over what a classical computer could do. Just this year, there were finally sort of independent groups, mainly at USC, that sort of studied these devices and actually studied the machine that Lockheed bought and tried to characterize it. And the current situation is that there is some evidence for that there really is some kind of quantum behavior going on in this device. There is no evidence at present that it sort of does anything faster than your laptop could also do the same thing. I've been, you know, actually the last 2 weeks, you know, the last 3 weeks sort of nonstop sort of on the phone with journalists, you know, trying to, you know, sort of get this message out over and over, because, you know, it's, you know, I feel like the current level of hype is sort of unsustainable. by the way, you know, when like most people introduce themselves, they say, you know, hi, how are you? When people introduce themselves to me, they say, so what's the deal with D-Wave? So this is, you know, like, you know, I got into this just because, you know, it's the question that sort of everyone asked me. So, you know, I had to, you know, look into it, you know, and you know, so it's like, you know, we hope that that they, you know, succeed, but it's, you know, I think it's very, very important to try to, you know, separate out, you know, what's been demonstrated from what hasn't been, and to just, you know, try to keep a clear-eyed perspective. And, you know, and one of my hopes for this talk will be, you know, that I'll sort of give you, you know, the tools to be able to evaluate, you know, stuff that you read about quantum computing, you know, in the press, you know, on your own, and sort of form, you know, your own sort of, you know, informed judgments about it. Okay, so, good. So, all right, so I should say, what is a quantum computer exactly, right? And okay, you know, it's actually, you know, not that hard to answer the question, okay? But to answer it, we first have to step back and say, what is quantum mechanics? Okay, so here, you know, if I can editorialize a little bit more, you know, I think that, you know, the physicists really, you know, somehow fooled, you know, almost everyone for almost a century into thinking that quantum mechanics is somehow complicated and hard. Okay, here's the truth. Okay, yes, it's extremely counterintuitive. Okay, but complicated? Absolutely not. The quantum mechanics is actually turns out to be unbelievably simple once you take the physics out of it. Okay, so you know, yes, if you want to, you know, calculate, you know, make actual predictions about, you know, the hydrogen or the helium atom, yes, of course that's complicated, but, you know, that the complication just comes from, you know, understanding the, you know, the nucleus and the behavior of electrons and all that stuff. You know, but the sort of central sort of conceptual aspect of quantum mechanics, the thing that I think really, you know, interests people, interests, you know, most non-physicists about it, can sort of be explained independently of all of that. You know, really what it is it's a certain generalization or change to the laws of probability themselves, okay? And this sort of generalized probability theory, or quantum probability, if you like, is, you know, in some sense the only thing that you need to understand what quantum computing is all about. Okay, if you want to actually build a quantum computer, then again, you need to know, you know, some physics and chemistry and so forth. Okay, but to understand, you know, at a mathematical level what a quantum computer is, right? It's really just this generalized probability calculus, and then some linear algebra. Okay, so, you know, I can show it to you. All right, so I guess, you know, I'll start with sort of the famous experiment that sort of proved to the world, you know, in the 1910s or, you know, 1920s, that, you know, a different way of calculating probabilities was needed when we go to the subatomic realm. So this is the this double slit experiment. Okay, and this is where you take a photon. So this is my rendering of a photon. And you shoot it at a screen with two slits in it, and then you look at where it ends up on a second screen. Okay, and the behavior of the photon, the first thing you find is that it is probabilistic. Sometimes it goes through the first slit, sometimes through the second one. You know, if the slits are narrow enough, then it can sort of diffract a little. So sometimes it goes up here, sometimes down there, sometimes like that. Okay, and sometimes people say, what's really spooky and weird about quantum mechanics is that it's probabilistic, you know, and this is what, you know, Einstein couldn't accept, that God plays dice and so forth. Okay, so, you know, who cares, you know, about probability? Okay, that's the, you know, I mean, probabilities are, you know, we deal with them all the time in, you know, in every domain, right? You know, if photons want to use probabilities too, more power to them, right? That's not the strange part about quantum mechanics. Okay, the strange part is all, you know, in what you have to do to calculate the probabilities. Okay, so it's clear that to know exactly what a photon will do, you know, in this situation or in any other situation, you know, you may need some detailed physical theory. Okay, but, you know, let me just state a fact that should be completely, you know, that seems like it should be completely obvious, you know, just independent of any physics details. Okay, let's just let P be the probability that the photon will be found on in a particular region on the second screen. Okay, and of course, you know, we could estimate this probability if we like by just taking a whole bunch of photons and shooting them one by one, you know, at our screens, and then just collecting the statistics about how many of the photons end up in this region. Right, so we can estimate this probability P. Okay, so now let's say let P sub A be the probability that the photon, you know, ends up in this region after having passed through the first slit, and let P sub B be the probability that it ends in that region after having, you know, passed through the second slit, then whatever else is true, you would expect that P would just be the sum of those two probabilities, right? Okay, but this is exactly what you find to not be the case. So what you find is that, you know, if both slits are open, then there's a pattern of light and dark fringes, they're called. Okay, so there are some places where, you know, a photon can appear and with a decent probability, and then in between them, there are these places where the photon almost never appears. Okay, but now the strange part is that if you take one of those dark places where the photon, you know, almost never appears, and you close one of the slits, let's say you close just one of the two slits, then you find that the photon can appear, you know, appears with a much higher probability in that place. Okay, so in other words, what you find is that, you know, the probability for the photon to get there, just having gone through, you know, when only one slit is open, is greater than the probability that the photon ends up there when both slits are open. Okay, so, you know, this seems to violate, you know, an axiom of, you know, of probability theory, right? How could increasing the number of ways for the photon to get through decrease the chance that you're going to find it in a particular place? Okay, now what makes it even worse is that, you know, you may say, all right, well, you know, that sounds crazy, so why don't I just look and see which slit the photon is going through, you know, and then, you know, at least I'll you know, get a better idea of what's going on, okay? As soon as you look to, you know, you can do that, you can monitor, you know, set up little detectors and see to check which slit it's going through, but then you find that this interference pattern will disappear, okay? So then it really will look like, yes, the photon just went through one slit or through the other slit, you know, and so what you'll see instead of this pattern is, like, you know, like maybe like a Gaussian over here and a second Gaussian over here, and nothing more complicated than that. Okay, so now, you know, to forestall confusion, I should quickly add that, you know, in order to get this effect of destroying the interference pattern, you know, it's not important that a human being is actually the one looking. You know, you might say, well, you know, does this prove that the universe, you know, cares about you know, whether there are human, you know, conscious minds around? Well, no, it doesn't prove that. You know, whether it does or doesn't, certainly this doesn't prove it. Okay, so, you know, and the way to see that is that, you know, you could have a mechanical recording device which is recording, you know, just which slit the photon goes through, and, you know, that will also destroy the interference pattern just as well. Okay, and so what turns out to be sort of necessary and sufficient to get rid of this weird interference phenomenon is for the information about which slit the photon went through to leak out into any feature of the external environment. Okay, so in other words, if the information about which slit the photon went through gets recorded anywhere, and recorded could mean in the configurations of the surrounding air molecules, okay, or in, you know, the polarization, you know, of another photon that happened to pass by, or, you know, or it could mean in a, you know, written on a piece of paper, or you know, or anything, right? If the information gets recorded elsewhere, then you don't see the interference pattern, okay? But only if the photon gets to sort of keep its full privacy, okay, then that's when it does this weird thing, okay? So, and that's when we have to switch to using this these alternative rules for probability. Okay, so what are these, you know, alternative rules for probability? Okay, so that you know, people ultimately, you know, came up with to account for these phenomena. So so the short answer is that quantum mechanics is sort of what you would inevitably come up with if you tried to invent something that was like probability theory, but you wanted it to be based on the 2 norm of a vector instead of the 1 norm of a vector. Okay, what do I mean by that? Well, so what's probability theory? Okay, probability is a calculus, you know, for encoding your knowledge of any kind of system, where you know, you represent the state of the system by a vector. Okay, it's a vector of real numbers, and of course these real numbers have to be non-negative, and they have to add up to 1. Okay, you know, at a mathematical level, in some sense, probability theory is just sort of this calculus for how you manipulate these vectors. Okay, so quantum mechanics is going to be, you know, just the same thing, except that now, instead of the state of our system, you know, being represented by a vector of non-negative real numbers, now it's going to be represented by a vector of complex numbers. Okay, these complex numbers are called amplitudes. You can think of them as sort of like pre-probabilities. Okay, so each amplitude is a complex number, and now the normalization rule is that the sum of the squares of the absolute values of the amplitudes should be 1. Okay. This is, you know, if you've studied linear algebra, this is just the standard normalization rule, you know, for a vector of complex numbers, saying that it should be a unit vector. Okay, it should have unit 2 norm. Okay. But now, you know, sort of except for this one change, you know, everything else about quantum mechanics, you know, almost exactly parallels, you know, the laws of probability theory. Okay, so I do have to say, you know, this is, don't tell any physicists that I let you in on the secret, okay, because, you know, they try to keep, you know, they try to, you know, convince people that they have to study for, you know, for years and years before they get to this, but okay. So, you know, this is really the core, and you know, actually, I think that, you know, mathematicians could perfectly well have invented this, let's say in the 1800s, you know, with no impetus from experiment. Now, the historical fact is that they didn't. You know, it took, like hundreds of experiments for, you know, for people to finally sort of have their noses rubbed in this and be, you know, convinced that okay, you have to use this alternate probability calculus, you know, if you want a workable theory of atoms and molecules. Okay, but you know, in some sense, this is like an accident of history, right? In some alternate universe, right? You can imagine that mathematicians would have come up with this from pure thought. So, okay, but I have to say a little bit more. So, you know, the first issue is, okay, you know, I have this vector of complex numbers, right? I can say that the state of my system is anything, right? I could say that it's, you know, a vector of quaternions or of rooted trees or whatever, right? But then I still have to tell you what does it mean, right? So, you know, in particular, if I actually look at my system, then what is going to happen, right? So this vector, you know, you should think of it as describing some quantum system that has n possible sort of outcomes that you could get if you made a measurement on the system, right? So we'll imagine that you are able to measure the system in a way that reliably tells you that the system is in one of the states, 1, 2, 3, 4, up to n. Okay, so, you know, of course, when we make measurements, you know, we do see a definite outcome, right? And I'm, you know, just assuming for simplicity for now that it's just one of a finite number of possible outcomes. Okay, so fine. So there are n possible outcomes if you make a measurement. And now, you know, what you would like to know is, well, then what is the probability that I'm going to see outcome I? Okay, because, of course, you know, in the, you know, ordinary world, right, if I, you know, tell you that there's a negative 30% chance, you know, of rain tomorrow, or, you know, or worse yet, like a minus 0.4 I chance, right, then you'll tell me that I'm smoking crack, right? So, you know, so we need some way to convert these weird numbers into ordinary probabilities, okay? And the way we do that is just, we say the probability of outcome I is the squared absolute value of the ith amplitude. Can people see this? I should write it up here. Okay, and so you'll notice that because this vector has unit 2 norm, then the corresponding probability vector will have unit 1 norm. Okay, so that's, you know, exactly as it should be. You know, we need the probabilities of our mutually exclusive outcomes to add up to 1. Okay, but now, you know, the more interesting part is, well, what else can you do with this vector besides measuring it right away? So with a probability vector, we know, you know, if you've, we know how, you know, how you update that vector when something gets done to your system. Okay, namely, you know, any sort of transformation of your system can be represented by just a matrix vector multiply, right? So some matrix will hit your vector. You'll get a new vector. Okay, and you know, this matrix has to satisfy the property that it always maps, you know, probability vectors to other probability vectors. Okay, so in other words, it has to conserve the 1 norm of any non-negative vector. Okay, but there's a name for such a matrix. It's called a stochastic matrix. Okay, you know, it's easy to prove that a matrix is stochastic if and only if, first of all of its entries are non-negative. Okay, and second of all, the sum of the entries in every column is 1. Okay, so you can, so the rule in classical probability is that you can take your vector and you can hit it with any stochastic matrix, okay, to evolve it to a new vector. Okay, so in quantum mechanics, you know, as I said, the rule is almost exactly parallel. Here you get to take your vector of amplitudes and you get to hit it with any matrix that always maps unit vectors, your vector satisfying this property to other vectors satisfying this property. Okay, so you can map, you know, your transformation has to always map vectors of unit two norm to themselves in order that probability will be conserved. Okay, well, there's again a name for matrices that always conserve the two norm, and the name is unitary matrix. Okay, and a unitary matrix, it's not hard to prove that a matrix is unitary. Well, there's several conditions. You could say if and only if its inverse is equal to its conjugate transpose. Okay, that's one condition. Another condition is just to say that the rows of the matrix form an orthonormal basis, right, or just a bunch of orthogonal unit vectors. And that's actually equivalent also to saying that the columns of the matrix form an orthonormal basis. Okay, so so let's just see a couple of examples. Okay, so you know, so the easiest examples concern, you know, the simplest possible quantum system, which is a quantum bit or a qubit. Okay, so a qubit is just, you know, a two-level quantum system. So we just set n equal to 2. Okay, and now we have a system that, you know, where when it's measured, it can be found to be in one of two perfectly distinguishable states, which we label the 0 and 1 states. Okay, these could be almost anything. So for example, it could be, you know, an electron which is either in its ground state or in its first excited state. Okay, it could be a photon which is either polarized horizontally or polarized vertically. It could be an electron which is either spinning one way or spinning the other way. Okay, so physicists, you know, like to represent quantum states using these asymmetric brackets that tend to drive computer scientists up a wall. Okay, but you actually get used to them. They're actually really nice. They're called Dirac-Ketz. So basically, you know, you can just take anything you want and surround it with these Ketz to say, you know, this is a quantum state. Okay, it really is just a sort of a fancy notation for vectors. Okay, so 0 and 1 here represent two orthogonal vectors. Okay, so let's draw a picture. So if we had the plane, right here would be 0, and here would be 1. Okay, but now we can also take, you know, any complex linear combination of these two orthogonal vectors, as long as, you know, it gives us another unit vector. So we could take any state psi, which would be alpha 0 plus beta 1. Okay, this is called a superposition of the 0 and 1 states. And it has to satisfy that absolute value of alpha squared plus absolute value of beta squared equals 1. So, you know, of course, if we just, for simplicity, look at real amplitudes only, then the possible states of one qubit will just be a circle. Will just be the circle alpha squared plus beta squared equals 1. Okay, so we'll have possibilities like 0 plus 1 over the square root of 2. Okay, and this state is, you know, its importance is often abbreviated the plus state. Okay, this is like an equal superposition of 0 and 1. Okay, you could have a superposition which is mostly 0 but a little bit 1. Or vice versa. Then, you know, you could have a superposition like this, which is, this one is minus 0 plus 1 over square root of 2, often abbreviated the minus state. Okay? You notice that just like 0 and 1 is an orthogonal basis, right? So plus and minus is also an orthogonal basis. Okay? And so you're allowed to measure a qubit, you know, along any orthogonal basis you like. So you could ask the qubit whether it's 0 or it's 1, and then, you know, you'll get an answer where, you know, 0 equal, you know, with probability equal to the squared projection of your vector onto the 0 state, you know, and 1 with probability the squared projection of your vector onto the 1 state. Okay, but then you could also ask your qubit whether it's plus or minus. And then, you know, and then you'll project onto those two states. Okay, now, by the way, an important point about measurement is that, you know, you only get one chance to measure your quantum state. Okay, so let's say you had a superposition of 0 and 1. Let's say you measured it in the 0, 1 basis, and you got the answer 0. Okay, then if you look a second time, you're just going to get 0 again. Okay, it's picked its answer, and it's sticking with it. So, you know, it's not like you get to make independent samples. Okay, and that's a you know, so you should choose your measurement wisely. Okay, this is a very, very, you know, important and much discussed property of quantum states. So now, you know, the more interesting part is that, you know, in addition to taking these states and measuring them, we can also apply unitary transformations to them. Okay, so let's give an example of a unitary transformation. Okay, so here's a 2x2 matrix. You can check that it's unitary. It's often called the square root of not. Okay, why is it called that? Well, because let's consider what happens if you take this matrix and you apply it to the zero state. So the zero state corresponds to the vector 1, 0, right? Saying that you have all of your amplitude on the state 0 and none of your amplitude on the state 1. Okay, and so you can check, you know, and so this will produce as output the plus state. Okay, so we could say that square root of not 0 applied to 0 gives you plus. Okay, likewise, you can check that square root of not applied to plus gives you 1. Okay, so in fact, this matrix is nothing other than just a rotation by 45 degrees counterclockwise in the plane. Okay, so you could keep going. Square root of not applied to 1 will give you the minus state. Okay, and square root of not applied to the minus state will give you, well, it will actually give you the state minus 0, right? You'll get from here, you know, up, and then over to here to minus 0. Okay, but in quantum mechanics, it turns out that minus 0 is equal to 0. Okay, in the sense that, you know, these two states are, you know, are just different notations for the same physical thing, right? In particular, you can check that any measurement you could possibly make, you know, on this state will yield, you know, the same probability distribution over outcomes as any measure as that measurement made on this state. Okay, why? Because, you know, you're just, you know, all that happens is that your entire vector has been multiplied by minus 1, right? But when you calculate probabilities, you have to take the squared absolute values of the amplitudes in your vector, and when you take the squared absolute values, then those minus 1s just drop out. Okay, so that's why we say that in quantum mechanics, the global phase of a vector is irrelevant. Okay, multiplying your whole vector by, you know, the same by a complex scalar does nothing. Okay, it's like moving the entire universe 10 feet to the left. You know, it could happen and no one would notice. Right, so it's a symmetry of the, you know, of the theory. Okay, you know, on the other hand, relative phase certainly can matter. Okay, so the plus, you know, the state 0 plus 1 and the state 0 minus 1 down here are certainly not the same state. In fact, they're orthogonal states. Okay, and if two states are orthogonal, then in fact they can be distinguished from each other perfectly by a measurement. Okay, so this, you know, square root of not gate already does something that has no classical analog, which is that it's something that, you know, when applied twice in succession, gives you the not of your bit, right? When you apply it only once, then it sort of, you know, does the superposition thing. Okay, so let me, where's the eraser? Another way to think about what this square root of not is doing is just in terms of, interference of amplitudes. Okay, so I can, you know, imagine I start with the state 0, and then I apply that square root of not transformation once, then I get an equal superposition of 0 and 1. Each one has amplitude 1 over square root of 2. Okay, and now imagine I do it a second time. Well, I can think of my second operation as just acting independently on the two components, 0 and 1, right? Because everything is, quantum mechanics is a completely linear theory, right? Or, you know, unitary evolution is a completely linear process. Okay, so I can just say, you know, I have a branching tree of possibilities. Okay, and, you know, the 0 gets mapped once again to 1 over square root of 2, 0, plus 1 over square root of 2, 1. The 1, on the other hand, if you look over at the matrix, gets mapped to minus 1 over square root of 2, 0, and 1 over square root of 2, 1. Okay, so now I can define the amplitude for each path to be the product of all the amplitudes along the path. So, for example, this path has amplitude half, right? This path also has amplitude half. This path has amplitude minus a half. Okay, and this one has amplitude half. Okay, and now the rules that define the final amplitude for a configuration, like let's say 0, I have to add up the amplitudes for all of the possible paths that end in that configuration. Okay, so so what will be the final amplitude for 0? Well, it will just be here's a half, and here's minus a half. So it's 0. Okay, what will be the final amplitude for 1? Well, I'll get a half from this path, and I'll get a half from this path. So it's 1. Okay, and so in some sense, this is why sort of applying this randomizing operation twice in succession mapped us from the state 0 to definitely the state 1. Okay, because it's like there are two possible paths that the system could have taken that would have brought it back to the state 0. Okay, but one of those paths had a positive amplitude, and the other path had a negative amplitude. And as a result, they, as we say, interfered destructively and canceled each other out. Okay, and so then, you know, the 0 outcome is never observed at all. Okay, by contrast, the two paths that led to the 1 outcome interfered constructively. They both had the same sign. Okay, and, you know, in some sense, you know, anytime anyone ever tells you anything about quantum mechanics, right, whether it's about entanglement or tunneling or Schrodinger or cats that are alive and dead or, you know, blah, 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 right, whatever it is, either it's wrong, okay, or else it can ultimately be explained in terms of this one phenomenon of interference of positive and negative amplitudes. Okay, this is, you know, this is a point that doesn't get out much, okay? But in some sense, this is what underlies sort of every quantum phenomenon, okay? Okay, so let me just give, and as we're going to see shortly, quantum computing is nothing more than this same kind of phenomenon, but on a much more massive scale, okay? So another sort of very important one-qubit gate is what's called the Hadamard gate. Okay, and that's almost the same as the square root of naught, except that the minus entry is down in the lower right corner. Okay, and you can check that Hadamard is actually a square root of the identity matrix. Okay, so Hadamard twice gives you nothing. And, you know, the Hadamard is really a change of basis. So it maps the 0 state to the plus state and vice versa. And it maps the 1 state to the minus state and vice versa. Okay, so it's sort of like a device for switching from this basis to this diagonal one. Okay, so now you know about 1 qubit. So now I just have to tell you about 2 qubits. And then I can tell you about n qubits. Okay. Oh, yeah. Okay. So, you know, what if I have two qubits next to each other. So I could have an alpha zero plus, or let's say an A, I'll call it A zero plus B one. And I also have a C zero plus D one. Just, you know, sitting, you know, these are just two different electrons in my lab, let's say. Okay, I can always sort of put, you know, two systems together. Okay, mathematically, the operation is called the tensor product. So you, I can write it using this, using that symbol there. Okay, or often this symbol will just be omitted. Okay, and you'll just put two quantum states next to each other to denote that they're being tensored with each other. Okay, and all this really means is that you know, I can multiply through, you know, the same way that I would do like with any algebraic expression. Okay, except that I have to keep the order clear. So 0, 1 is not the same as 1, 0. Right, you know, they don't commute. Okay, but other than that, you know, I can just manipulate this thing algebraically. So all this means is that I have an amplitude A times C for both qubits being in the state zero. Okay, I have an amplitude AD for the outcome zero, the, if you like, the two-bit string 0, 1. I have an amplitude BC for 1, 0, and an amplitude BD for 1, 1. Okay, and by the way, when I have, you know, several kets, you know, next to each other, sometimes we'll be even lazier, and we'll just put them all in, you know, they'll be roommates, and okay, they'll share the same ket. Okay, so I can certainly, you know, have a state like this. Okay, and you know, and once again, the amplitudes have to be normalized, and you know, and the rules will be like, you know, if I you know, measure both of the qubits, then I'll find them in the state 0, 0 with probability alpha c absolute squared. You know, I'll find them in the state 0, 1 with probability, I'm sorry, probability ac absolute square, in the state 0, 1 with probability ad absolute square, and so forth. Okay, and then, you know, there's you know, you can easily also give a rule for what happens if you measure only one of the qubits and not the other one. Okay, then, you know, it's really just like the rule for conditional probabilities, you know, in so, okay, so like if I have a state like alpha 0, 0 plus beta 0, 1 plus gamma 1, 0 plus delta 1, 1, and let's say I measure only the first qubit, then I'll get the outcome 0 with probability absolute value of alpha squared plus absolute value of beta squared. And I'll get the outcome 1 with probability absolute value of gamma squared plus absolute value of delta squared, right? Because these are the two configurations, you know, with a 1 in the first position, and these are the two with a 0 in the first position. Okay, and then my state will partially collapse to one of these two superpositions over two outcomes. Okay, except that now I'll have to renormalize the vector so that the, you know, so that it's again a unit vector. Okay, so those are the rules for, you know, for dealing with two qubits. Okay, I can also, if I like, you know, apply an operation, like let's say a Hadamard operation, to only one of my two qubits. Okay, and oh, no, it's not. I'm just saying that, that you get 0 with this probability and 1 with this probability. Yeah, good. Okay. Sorry, these are arrows. Okay, so, right, so I could have a state like 0, 0. I could Hadamard the first qubit only, and then I'll get the state plus 0. Okay, or, you know, and then, you know, or I could do 3 square root of knots to the second qubit, and then my state will be plus minus. Okay, and so forth. Okay, this is on the second qubit. Okay, so but now what's more interesting about two qubits is that. I could also have a state like 0, 0 plus 1, 1 over square root of 2. Okay? And so let's see if we can factor this state, you know, as a tensor product of the state of the first qubit and the state of the second qubit. Okay, so it's just, you know, an algebra problem. We just have to set this state equal to A0 plus B1 tensor C0 plus D1. Okay, and then solve for A, B, C, and D. Okay, to find out, you know, how to factor this state. Okay. Well, what happens when we do that? We find that AC had better be 1 over square root of 2, right? BD should also be 1 over square root of 2. Let's see, AD should be 0, right? Because there's no amplitude here for the 0, 1 state, okay? And BC should also be 0, okay? But now we notice a difficulty, which is that these two imply that ABCD equals a half, whereas these two imply that ABCD equals 0. Okay, so the conclusion is that there is no solution to this problem. Okay, so we have a state of two qubits that cannot be factored as, you know, as the state of the first qubit tensor, the state of the second qubit. Okay, when you have a state like that, it's called, you know, as you may have heard, an entangled state. Okay, so this is what entanglement is. In some sense, it's just the quantum version of correlation between two random variables. And, you know, in fact, the generic case, you know, if you just pick a two-qubit state at random, almost all of them will be entangled. It will only be a tiny, you know, or a measure zero fraction of them that will be factorable. In some sense, you know, it means that each, okay, so let me talk about what it means. So what this is saying is that, you know, each, to write out the state of the system, you know, we have to talk about sort of both of the qubits together, right? You know, if we don't, then we're sort of leaving something out. Okay, now, you know, people sort of argued about, you know, the nature of entanglement, you know, for decades. You know, and Einstein, you know, couldn't accept it. He called it spooky action at a distance. And, you know, there was this famous paper about it. Okay, you know, and people debate, you know, well, but what did he really believe? And what did Niels Bohr really believe? Okay, I'm going to sort of take a modern perspective, which is that, you know, those people were mostly just confused, okay? And that's okay, because, you know, everyone, you know, it is confusing when you're just discovering something new. That's, you know, it would, you know, that's always how it is, okay? But today, you know, I think that we have a much clearer understanding of entanglement, which is sort of focused around the question, you know, not sort of what is its true essence, but what does it let you do? Okay, what can you use an entangled state to do, and what can you not use it to do? Okay, so the first, you know, so let's try to, you know, ask that question in order to get a better handle on sort of what entanglement means. So, you know, so the first question people have is, you know, if the two qubits are entangled, does that mean that, you know, you can use them to send a signal faster than light? Okay, so you know, so there is the point is when you have two qubits, right? There's no limit on how far apart they could be. Okay, so you could have let's say two electrons that were in, you know, a state like this, this one here, you know, one of them could be on Earth and the other could be on Mars. Okay, so let's, you know, traditionally, Alice, I guess, is the one on Earth and Bob is the one on Mars. Okay, so, you know, so they each hold one of the two qubits, okay, but these qubits are somehow still connected to each other. Okay, so does this mean that they have an instantaneous telephone between Earth and Mars, right? Well, you know, what exactly, we have to ask, what exactly do we mean by that? Okay, well, you know, the most natural meaning would seem to be, can Alice, by deciding to do something or not do something to her qubit, transmit a message of her choice instantaneously to Bob? Okay, now you notice if she could do this, then this would be a serious problem because this would flat out contradict, you know, the theory of relativity. Okay, which, you know, says that you know, well, people often say, you know, it says that nothing can go faster than light. But when you put it that way, it sounds like it's true just because, you know, Einstein decreed it. Okay, actually, the reason why it's true is that in someone, you know, if you're going faster than light, then in someone's reference frame, then you're also going backwards in time. Okay, so then you have to worry about what happens if you kill your own grandfather. So you know you're never born, and then you know, but then you were born, so you do kill him, and yeah. So if we don't want to deal with any of that, then we better not have any faster than light communication in our universe. Okay, so fortunately, it turns out that quantum mechanics upholds that principle. Okay, there is a theorem called the no communication theorem, which basically says that no matter what Alice could possibly do to her qubit, so any combination of unitary transformations, measurements, interacting the qubit with some third qubit, you know, anything like that, okay, as long as we don't condition on the outcome of a measurement that Alice makes, so, you know, so we don't know we just know that Alice is going to do this experiment. We don't know what measurement outcome she's going to get. Okay, but then the mere fact of Alice's doing the experiment will produce no observable change whatsoever that Bob can detect by measuring his qubit only. Okay, so, the basic, you know, I mean, you know, so I'm not going to prove this theorem, although it's just a few lines of linear algebra to prove it. But, you know, you can get an intuition for it by just, you know, thinking about what would you actually do to use this as a faster-than-light telephone, right? Well, Alice can measure her qubit, you know, in the 0-1 basis. Okay, of course she can do that. If she does, then she'll get 0 with probability half, and she'll get 1 with probability half. Okay, and if she gets 0, then we know that Bob's qubit will also be 0. Okay, if she gets 1, then we know that Bob, you know, if he measures, say, in the 0-1 basis, will also get 1. Okay, so, but now, what's the problem with this? Well, it's that, you know, Alice didn't get to choose which measurement outcome she got. Okay, it was just random, right? It was just 0 or 1 with equal probability. Okay, and so she doesn't know, you know, which outcome she's going to get, right? And so, you know, when Bob measures, you know, all he's going to see is he's going to see, again, 0 or 1 with equal probability. Okay, but that's what he would have seen even if he had measured, you know, just before Alice had measured. Okay, so, but, you know, Bob's measuring gives him no information about whether Alice did the measurement or not. Yeah, so this is why there's this no communication theorem that handles the general case, and which I'm not proving here. I'm just trying to give you the conceptual intuition, and then you know you can go do the math in private. Okay, so all right. Yeah, you know, but then you have to worry, what if Alice does a unitary transformation? Okay, again, you know, has no effect on the probabilities of the, you know, outcomes of measurements that Bob does only on his qubit. Okay, So then, you know, you might say, well, in that case, I guess, you know, entanglement is really, you know, really, really badly overhyped, right? It's, you know, we might as well just say, well, look, you know, if, you know, I pick up my copy of my newspaper outside my hotel room, you know, like, as, you know, I did this morning, and I see the headline, well, then, whoa, I instantaneously know the headline of your newspaper also. So it's like spooky action at a distance. Okay, well, of course it's not. That's just correlation of two random variables, right? And so maybe all that's going on with entanglement is that, right? Maybe it's just correlation, okay? And there's no need to posit anything else. That seems to be the sort of thing that Einstein was hoping would be true. Unfortunately, in addition to the no communication theorem, there is another famous result called the Bell inequality. Okay, and what the Bell inequality says is that there is a certain game that Alice and Bob could play with their entangled state, you know, which they can win with higher probability than they could possibly win it if they only had classical correlated random variables. So I can just tell you the game because it's simple enough. So the game is, so here's Alice. She receives a bit A. She receives a bit A, which is chosen, you know, which is uniformly random, okay? Zero or one with equal probability. Bob receives a bit B, which is also uniformly random. Okay, and now Alice has to output a bit X, and Bob has to output a bit Y. Okay, and they win the game if and only if the exclusive OR of X and Y equals the AND of A and B. Right, so it's a weird game. But okay, and they can agree on a strategy in advance. But once the game starts, then no communication is allowed between them. Okay, so they don't know. Alice doesn't know B. Bob doesn't know A. Okay, and, you know, and they could well be on different galaxies. Okay, so you can prove. You know, here's an easy theorem that you know you can prove yourself that you know the best possible strategy. Okay, what could Alice and Bob do to win this? Anyone have a strategy? Well, I mean, they could always just output zero, you know, no matter what happens. All right, if they do that, then they'll win 3/4 of the time. Okay, they'll win unless A and B are both one. Right, so they can certainly win 3/4 of the time, but you can prove yourself that they cannot win, you know, there is no strategy that lets them win with greater probability than 3/4. Okay, you know, whatever they do, you know, even if something probabilistic, even if they share random bits in advance, okay, they'll always fail at least 25% of the time. Okay, however, Bell noticed that if Alice and Bob share this quantum state here, which is actually, it's called the EPR pair after Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen. Sometimes it's also called the Bell pair. But if they share an EPR pair, so I'll say in the entangled case, then there is a strategy where Alice will measure her qubit in a basis depending on A, and she'll output whatever she sees as X. Bob will measure his half of the EPR pair in a basis depending on B, and he'll output whatever he sees as Y, and the EPR pair will correlate their results, you know, X and Y, in such a way that they will win the game with probability cosine squared pi over 8, which is about 0.85. Okay, and so when Bell, you know, published this in the 60s, this was, you know, just sort of a thought experiment, you know, and his point was that, you know, although quantum mechanics sort of does not allow faster than light communication, if you were to try to simulate quantum mechanics using classical physics, then the simulation would require faster than light communication. okay? Because, you know, there's this game, and, you know, if you want to reproduce the quantum predictions, you've got to win this game 85% of the time. And the only way to do that, classically, is for Alice and Bob to communicate. Okay? Now, you know, in the 1980s, people actually managed to do this experiment. And, you know, to the surprise of, you know, I think very few physicists, but to the great surprise of other people who sort of, you know, still refuse to accept it, you know, the outcome was this. So the game can be won 85% of the time, you know, in our world. So that's, you know, that's a, you know, main piece of evidence that, you know, that really we have to describe, you know, physics, you know, using these entangled states. Yeah. Oh yeah, yeah. So all right. Well, I said that, but I'll just re-say it, in, you know, with those words. A theory where, you know, which is purely classical, involving no entanglement, and where Alice, you know, and where there's no faster than light communication, is called a local hidden variable theory. Okay. So the idea of a local hidden variable theory is that, you know, there is something going on that we don't understand, where, like, when two entangled qubits are created, you know, that at the moment that they're entangled with each other, you know, they just agree on a plan. Okay, they say, listen, if anyone asks, you know, I'll be zero, you'll be one. Okay, but then they say, oh, but what if they measure in the plus minus basis? Say, okay, fine, if that happens, you know, I'll be minus, you'll be plus. And then they say, okay, but what if they measure in this other basis? Okay, and they just agree on a contingency plan for any measurement that could possibly be made, and then the qubits are separated, and then, you know, the measurements are done, and they accord with the plan, and somehow, you know, they have to convincingly simulate quantum mechanics in this way, using no faster than light influences. Okay, so that's called a local hidden variable theory, you know, and that's one formalization of what Einstein, you know, would have wanted. And so what the Bell inequality does is that it rules out that type of story. Okay, it says that, you know, if you want to believe in this sort of, you know, hidden conspiracy, you know, that the qubits are using to sort of simulate quantum mechanics, well, then you also have to believe in faster than light influences that are, you know, in order to sort of coordinate the answers. Okay. Good. Okay. So by the way, I should say something about, well, how is it that you entangle two qubits in the first place? Okay. So turns out that's actually, you know, very easy to do. So, you know, the simplest way is if your two qubits are just right next to each other in your lab. Okay, and then basically you just need sort of some sort of two-qubit interaction. Okay, so some unitary, you know, involving both of the qubits, which will be represented by a 4x4 unitary matrix. Okay, so for example, you know, you could start with two qubits in the state 0, 0. Okay, this is, you know, what we usually take as our sort of standard initial state in quantum computing theory, for simplicity. Okay, then you could Hadamard the first qubit, you know, and that will map the state to +0, or in other words, to 0, 0 plus 1, 0 over √2. Okay, and now the next step is that you can apply a two qubit unitary operation, another sort of very important one for quantum computing, which is called the controlled not gate, okay, or the C-not. Okay, and what the C-not does is it maps two bits, you know, that are, say, in this, say, 0, 0 to 0, 0, 0, 1 to 0, 1, 1, 0 to 1, 1, and 1, 1 to 1, 0. Okay, so in other words, it applies a not to the second qubit, but only if the first qubit is 1. Okay, if the first qubit is 0, then it does nothing. Okay, so you could also write this as, you know, each state x, y gets mapped to x, and then x exclusive OR with y. Okay, and you'll notice that, that this operation is reversible. In fact, it's its own inverse. Okay, so, you know, and that's every unitary transformation has to be reversible. Okay, so so that's, you know, so that checks out. And, you know, if you want to write the unitary matrix corresponding to the C-naught, then that will be a 4x4 matrix. And it will just be this one here. Okay? So, you know, just, you know, so say we label the entries in binary order, then, you know, the 1, 0 and the 1, 1 get flipped. Okay? So that's what this is saying. Okay, so we can do a C-naught to this state, and then what will happen is that 0, 0 will get mapped to itself, but 1, 0 will get mapped to 1, 1. Okay, so, you know, voila, we've produced entanglement where there was none before. Okay. Or, you know, as we say, we've entangled the qubits. Okay. Okay, so let me just explore, you know, a couple of other sort of crucial aspects of quantum information using, you know, using one or two qubits. Okay, so first is, you know, there's this thing you may have heard of called the no cloning theorem. So, you know, remember I said that you only get one chance to measure a qubit. You know, so you better choose wisely. So you might say, well, wouldn't it be great if we could get around that by just copying our qubit, right? And then, you know, we'd have a whole bunch of copies. We could measure, you know, each one, and then we could start to collect statistics about, you know, really, you know, what was our quantum state. So what we would like is a cloning transformation. And what would that do? We start, let's say, with a qubit, alpha 0 plus beta 1. Okay, we're here, you know, we'll assume that alpha and beta are unknown. Okay, so this is something that's just given to you by, you know, by some guy on the street. Okay, and, you know, you want to make a copy of it. So the question is, what do we mean by a copy? Right, well, so one thing that you can do, in fact, using a C-naught gate, is that you could, from this, easily produce the state alpha 0, 0 plus beta 1, 1. Okay, or alpha 0, 0, 0 plus beta 1, 1, 1, and so forth. Okay, but then think about that. That's not really two copies of the original state. That's just an entangled state that has the same amplitudes. Right, in particular, you know, if I took this alpha 0, 0 plus beta 1, 1, and I gave one qubit to Alice and the other qubit to Bob, then, you know, Alice will be able to tell, you know, just by measuring her qubit, that you didn't really give her a superposition of alpha of 0 and 1. Okay, because when she measures that, right, she'll, the entanglement with Bob's qubit will, as we say, decohere her qubit. Okay, so if you have, this is a very important principle. If you have a qubit, okay, but it's, you know, it's in a superposition state, but it's entangled with someone else, then that superposition just reverts to looking to you just like a classical probability distribution. Okay, so for example, with this EPR pair, right? If you can check that no matter what basis Alice measures her qubit in, she's just going to see, you know, the two outcomes both with equal probability. Okay, and that's different than if Alice had the state just 0 plus 1 over square root of 2, because that state she could measure in the plus state, and then she would always see the outcome plus. Okay, so in some sense, the fact that she even has a superposition at all is shielded from her by the fact that her superposition is entangled with Bob. Okay, so, you know, and I should say that So the big sort of philosophical mystery of quantum mechanics, right? The thing that people have argued about, for a century, is sort of what it sort of who decides when a measurement happens, right? The unitary evolution, of these vectors is, seems like it's easy enough to understand. Okay, maybe it's strange, fine, but it just, there's some law of physics that causes this vector to, evolve in time by, in some norm-preserving way. Okay, we can deal with that. But then this measurement just seems like this totally arbitrary separate rule that was tacked on top, okay, that was just tacked on by someone, right? And, so you might object, well, look, I'm also made of a whole bunch of qubits, right? I too am made of subatomic particles, and each of those particles should just obey the same laws as any other particles, which means that they too should be evolving by unitary evolution, right? And so what is it that comes in and decides, okay, now a measurement is being made, and now we're going to stop this unitary evolution and just see one outcome with the appropriate probabilities? Okay, so that's called the measurement problem of quantum mechanics. And, as I said, people have argued about it for a century. There's a whole menu of possible answers, one of which, so one answer is that there is just unitary evolution, and what you perceive as measurement, or what we perceive as measurement, is really just sort of a C-naught gate being applied from the thing that we're measuring to the configuration of our own body. Okay, so, or to put it another way, measurement is just the process by which we ourselves become entangled with the systems that we're measuring. Okay, now if you accept that view, then it seems to lead inescapably to the conclusion that, after we make a measurement, then we ourselves are in a superposition state. Okay, so there's some amplitude that we saw the one outcome, there's some amplitude that we saw the other outcome, and from there, it's not very far to the conclusion that, we are constantly sort of branching into parallel copies of ourselves, and they may have different life trajectories, and one goes to the summer school, and one decides to just stay home, and so forth. Okay, so that's one type of answer that some people advocate. Another type of answer that people advocate is shut up and stop asking the question. Niels Bohr put it a lot more eloquently than that. But that was really the essence of it. He said, but look, the goal of a scientific theory is to just tell you is to give you predictions for the outcomes of the measurements that you can make, right? And quantum mechanics does that. And anything else is just sort of meaningless metaphysics, right? In giving you the rule for what happens when you make a measurement, we've done everything that a physical theory was supposed to do. And if you thought that a physical theory was supposed to do more than that, well, then you just have to update your preconceptions, in order to fit them with quantum mechanics. Okay, so. Anyway, in the modern perspective, measurement, definitely has something to do with sort of us getting entangled, with the measuring apparatus or with the external environment becoming entangled with the system being measured, right? That's clearly sort of part of the process. And the debate is basically about whether that's all you need to account for the existence of measurement, or whether you need this additional step that says, okay, after you produce this entangled state, then there's something else that says that, okay, now one of these is going to be real. With half probability, this one will be real, and with half probability, this one will be real, and the other one will be unreal. Okay, do you need that additional step or not? So what was I saying? Okay, the no cloning theorem, that's right. So you can always sort of take your qubit and you can make copies of it this way, in this way that, you know, we we think, you know, is sort of what's going on when a measurement is made. Okay, but that's not really what we mean by copying the qubit. Okay, so you might ask, instead of doing this, can we have a, can we instead do this? Can we have a map that takes, say, alpha 0 plus beta 1 plus some other qubit, which is initially in the state 0, and that maps it to a tensor product of two copies of alpha 0 plus beta 1? Okay. And this, I claim, is not possible. Why not? Well, let's just expand this out, right? All this means is it's alpha squared 0, 0 plus alpha beta 0, 1 plus alpha beta 1, 0 plus beta squared 1, 1. Okay, so and so now, you know, what we would need to affect this is we'd need a linear transformation that takes the vector alpha beta 0 0 for any alpha and beta, and which maps it to alpha squared alpha beta beta squared. Okay, but now the problem is obvious. You know, these are quadratic functions of the original amplitudes. Okay, there is no linear transformation that's going to give you quadratics as the output. Okay, and that's, you know, that's really all there is to this no cloning theorem. Okay, you know, but it, as simple as it is to prove, you know, it has some amazing conceptual implications. So, you know, it basically, you know, tells us that quantum states have a certain privacy to them. Okay, you've heard that, you know, information wants to be free, right? Or you know, the free software advocates, right, like to, you know, say this, that, you know, you can't sort of, you know, clamp down information. Okay, but quantum information is not like that. You know, it wants to be sort of private. So, you know, and in fact, you can push that idea a lot further. And there are several, you know, sort of amazing sort of practical applications, you know, so, I mean, some of which have already been deployed today that are based on this no cloning theorem. Okay, so let me give you some examples. So first is what's called a quantum money. So the idea here is that you could have a quantum state which someone can make a measurement on in order to verify that, you know, this is authentic, say, legal tender. Okay, but, you know, no one should be able to make a measurement that will produce two copies of this quantum state. Okay, so this should be money which is physically impossible to counterfeit. Okay, a state that's, you know, just impossible to copy, you know, according to the laws of physics, okay, but which is also verifiable. Okay, and this was an idea proposed by Stephen Wiesner in 1969. Now, you know, Wiesner's scheme had a big drawback, which was that in his scheme, the only entity that was able to authenticate the money was the bank that printed it. So if you want to verify a bill, you have to take it back to the bank. And then the bank, you know, looks up in a giant table, you know, in which basis should it measure each of your qubits, you know, and then it knows that the thing checks out. Okay, but if someone doesn't know how the state was prepared, well, then the trick is that on each bill, sort of half of the qubits are going to be either in the 0 or 1 basis, and half of them will be either in the plus or minus basis. Okay, and now a counterfeiter, in order to make a copy of the bill, they would have to be able to guess, basically, for each qubit, in which basis was it prepared. Okay, because if they try to measure a qubit in the wrong basis, then not only will they fail to make a copy, but they'll even destroy the first copy that they had. Okay, so, and the chance that they would choose the right basis, you know, for each of the qubits, you know, falls off exponentially with the number of qubits. Okay, so that's so that was this idea for quantum money. Now, sort of the more modern question was, could you have quantum money that anyone can authenticate, okay, not only the bank that printed it. So I called this public key quantum money, you know, by analogy to a public key cryptography. And so in recent work, just a year ago, my student Paul Cristiano and I came up with sort of the first scheme for public key quantum money, where we could actually argue for its security, sort of based on some sort of cryptographic assumption. So, you know, in addition to the no cloning theorem, we needed to assume that some problem is computationally hard. Okay, but, you know, we can state our problem that, you know, that should be hard, and it looks like it's hard. And it seems like you can actually do this. Now, I should mention that there is a practical problem with quantum money, which is that we have to somehow keep, you know, quantum states are very fragile, right? If they interact with their external environment, then it's as if they were measured by their environment. Okay, so as we say, the states decohere. They lose their quantum coherence, or they lose their superposition properties as a result of interaction with their external environment. Okay, so basically, you know, you would have to keep this money extremely well shielded in your wallet. So, you know, this would have to be some wallet. It may have to, you know, cool the money to close to absolute zero. You know, you may have to drag around, you know, a giant sort of liquid helium cooling system with you, you know, into the convenience store or whatever. You know, and even in the most sort of carefully controlled laboratory conditions, right now, people have only managed to keep one qubit coherent for about 15 minutes. Okay, so, you know, I mean, maybe in today's economy, that's enough, right? You know, I don't know. But, you know, most qubits, by the way, you know, will lose their coherence on the scale of microseconds or even less than that. So that's the one sort of little practical issue with, you know, why we don't have quantum money yet, I guess. Okay, so, but there's another related idea that actually is practical today and, you know, has actually been deployed, you know, to some small extent. And this is called quantum key distribution or quantum cryptography. And so this is a form of cryptography which does not rely on any computational assumption. Okay, so you don't have to believe in the hardness of factoring or anything like that. And, you know, Alice and Bob, you know, don't have to agree on a key in advance in order to exchange secret messages. Okay, but they do need to have a quantum channel. They need to have a fiber optic cable across which they can send polarized photons, you know, in order for them to send qubits back and forth. So, and the basic idea with QKD is that, there may be an eavesdropper on the line who is, you know, who is trying to measure, you know, the qubits. Okay, but, you know, Alice and Bob can do some tests after exchanging their qubits in order to verify that no one has tampered with the qubits. Because if Eve tried to either steal the qubits or make a copy of them, right, well, she can't make a copy of them because of the no cloning theorem. Okay, so, you know, if whatever Eve tried to do, you know, in order to gain information about the qubits, you know, her very doing that would alter the state of the qubits in such a way that Alice and Bob would be able to detect that there is an eavesdropper on the line. Okay, and then, you know, they can just sort of abort the protocol or, you know, wait for the eavesdropper to go away or something. Okay, so, you know, and as I said, there's actually two companies that are now selling QKD systems. You know, and of course, you know, there are all sorts of practical, you know, issues that might make them insecure, right? So the first demonstration of QKD in the 1980s by Charlie Bennett and Gilles Brassard had the problem that, you know, it had these two detectors on a tape, these two photon generators and, you know, photon detectors on a table, you know, one for Alice and one for Bob. But, you know, but they clicked whenever they were sending a qubit. And when they were sending, if you were trying to send a one, it made a different sound of click than if you were sending a zero. Okay, so, you know, in any cryptographic system, there can be all sorts of back-channel attacks, as they're called, right, that sort of violate, you know. Likewise, if there's a little error or if there's a little noise in the system, then maybe that can be exploited. Okay, and so this is, you know, a whole topic that people have actively researched for, you know, the last few decades. But now, you know, there are QKD systems on the market, you know, that seem like, you know, that look like they're pretty secure. You know, but you know, a big question is there any market for them? Okay, because, you know, we already have public key cryptography, right, and it's, you know, it's plenty good enough for, you know, you could say it's plenty secure enough for most applications. You know, and ironically, we might need to build quantum computers in order to break all of our current public key crypto systems and thereby create a market for quantum key distribution. Okay. You know, and you can have more fun with this. So one thing I've been, you know, researching recently is the possibility of a quantum copy-protected software. So this would be a quantum state that, you know, lets you compute some function, but it would not let you create more states that, you know, would let you compute the same function. Okay. And, you know, I'm hoping to sell this idea, you know, to Microsoft or someone for a lot of money. But, you know, once we solve the problem of how do we keep the software from decohering in a matter of seconds. Okay. Okay, so one more issue that I should address, because it comes up a lot, and because, after all, this is an information theory summer school, is how much information is there in a qubit, let's say. So, you know, in my opinion, the best answer to this question is there is one qubit of information. Okay, so let's see, you know, what the issue is, right? If you try to give sort of a more classical answer than that. Okay, well, so how could we attempt to measure? Yeah. Yeah, of course. So that's let me now do that. So what could we mean by information? Well, there's a couple possibilities. Okay, so let's say we want to know, you know, how many classical bits does one qubit correspond to? Okay, well, what do we mean by that? Okay, we could ask how many classical bits are needed to specify the state of our qubit. Okay. So we have this alpha 0 plus beta 1. And we could ask how many classical bits are needed to specify it. Okay. Unfortunately, the answer will then be infinity. Okay, because alpha and beta can be arbitrary complex numbers that satisfy the normalization condition. Okay, and, you know, and we have, you know, no one has had any success, by the way, in constructing a theory where alpha and beta would have to be rational numbers, or they would have to be, you know, they would get cut off after, you know, the thousandth, you know, decimal place. Okay, you know, that just doesn't seem to make mathematical sense. So, you know, it really does seem like, you know, you know, now, of course, in practice, you know, you'll always be limited by the precision of your preparation and measurement devices, right? So, you know, so you'll never be able to prepare this state exactly, but only something that's maybe, you know, somewhere close to it. But, you know, there seems like, you know, as we got more and more precise in our preparation, that there's no limit to how much information, you know, you could, in some sense, encode into just a single qubit. Hey, and that you know, that should seem disconcerting to you, right? Okay, but now let's instead ask the question. Okay, you know, keeping with this theme of, you know, in quantum mechanics, you know, the rule is always if you want to get sensible answers, then phrase your questions in terms of what you can and can't do. Okay, rather than in terms of what is the true nature of something. Because, you know, because the former question, you know, we can actually try to figure out answers to. So keeping with that, yeah, we can also ask how many classical bits, let's say, can you store in a qubit and then reliably retrieve later by measuring the qubit, okay? And in that case, this has to be proved, but there's an important theorem called Halevo's theorem, which says that the answer to that is exactly one bit, no more, okay? So, you know, and furthermore, if let's say, you know, Alice and Bob, have a quantum channel, and Alice sends an n qubit state to Bob, and Bob then measures that state. Halevo's theorem says that Bob can learn no more than n classical bits. Or Alice can transmit to Bob, you know, reliably, exactly n classical bits. You know, which is just what, you know, she could do in the obvious way, and no more than that. Okay, so somehow, you know, as soon as we change the question from how many bits do you need to describe the state to your qubit to how many bits can you actually get out by measuring your qubit, then, you know, the answer decreases, you know, from infinity to one. Okay, right, you know, so those are two very different answers, right? And yet there are yet other ways of defining information, you know, according to which one qubit would correspond to two classical bits. Okay, so let me mention some of those. So there's a famous protocol discovered in 1993 called quantum teleportation. And I mean, it sounds cooler than it is, but it still is very cool. So what quantum teleportation is it's a way that Alice can transmit a qubit to Bob even if she only has a classical communication channel. Okay, so let's say Alice has a qubit, alpha 0 plus beta 1. She wants to get it over to Bob. Okay, but you know, she doesn't have like a quantum communication channel that can send qubits. And here's a little catch. Let's suppose that Alice and Bob did have the foresight to share in advance an EPR pair. Okay, so they do share, you know, an entangled quantum state, one that has no dependence, you know, on the particular state that Alice is trying to send to Bob. Right? This entanglement is just this generic resource that they share. Okay, then the protocol. We'll involve Alice making a measurement, a joint measurement, you know, so she'll do Hadamard and C-naught, and then she'll do a measurement, you know, jointly on the state psi and on her half of the entangled pair. That will give her two bits, you know, call them A and B, two classical bits that she'll then send to Bob. And then Bob, after receiving those bits, what correction operation he has to apply to his half of the EPR pair, and after applying that correction operation over on his side, he will get exactly the state psi that Alice had. Okay, so You know, so this was sort of, you know, an amazing thing that sort of violated many people's intuitions about what is and isn't possible in quantum mechanics. It actually has applications, you know, in quantum computing, for example. Now a very interesting feature of this teleportation protocol is that as a consequence of their Alice and Bob carrying out the protocol, Alice's copy of Psi necessarily gets destroyed. Okay, so Alice has to measure these two things to know what to send to Bob, you know, what classical bits to send him, and when she makes the measurement, then she destroys her copy of Psi. Okay, and so that, you know, afterward, only Bob has a copy of Psi. Now, can one, you know, fix that problem? Can one have a protocol where Bob would get Psi, but also Alice would have it? Well, the answer is no. Why? Because if so, that would violate the no cloning theorem. Okay, so this is a necessary feature of the protocol. Okay, you know, there's also a sort of converse. To quantum teleportation, which is called dense quantum coding. Okay, and this says, suppose Alice and Bob share an EPR pair, then by sending only one qubit to Bob, Alice can actually get two classical bits over to him, okay, of her choice. So actually, you know, I said before that Halevo's theorem says that, you know, by sending n qubits, you can only transmit n bits to your destination. Okay, but there's a little loophole in that, which is that if you share EPR pairs in advance with your destination, then by sending n qubits to your destination, you can send 2n classical bits. Okay, so you double the number of classical bits you can send. You can't do more than that, but you can get this doubling. Okay, and I can actually show you how it works, because it's really, really simple. So what is the EPR pair? It's just 0, 0 plus 1, 1 over square root of 2. Okay, and now all Alice is going to do is she's going to, you know, do some things to her half of the pair. Okay, so let's say, you know, there are two unitary matrices she could apply. There's this knot matrix, 0, 1, 1, 0, and there's the phase matrix. 1, 0, 0, -1. Okay? And so if Alice's first bit is a 1, then she'll apply the knot matrix, and otherwise she won't. Okay? If Alice's second bit is a 1, then she'll apply the phase matrix to her qubit, and otherwise she won't. Okay? And then after doing that, Alice will simply send her half of the EPR pair over to Bob. That's the one qubit that she sends. Okay, so let's look at what happens. Let's look at what Bob gets after Alice does that. So okay, if Alice's bits that she wanted to send were 0, 0, then she did nothing, right? She didn't apply this matrix or this one. So now Bob, you know, who now has both halves of the EPR pair, will just see the EPR pair, 0, 0 plus 1, 1 over root 2. Okay? If Alice was trying to send 0, 1, well then Alice applied only a phase but not a knot, and so Bob will have 0, 0, -1, 1. Okay? If Alice was sending a 1, 0, then she applied a knot, but not a phase. So Bob will see 0, 1 plus 1, 0. Okay, and if her bits were 1, 1, then she applied both. So Bob will see 0, 1 minus 1, 0. Okay. Now the point is that these four states are an orthonormal basis. Okay, so they're all, you can check that each one is orthogonal to the others, and because of that, all four of them can be distinguished perfectly by a measurement which Bob can perform. Okay, so quantum teleportation and dense quantum coding both tend to suggest that, you know, in some weird sense, one qubit sort of corresponds to two classical bits. Okay, so, you know, in this question, how much classical information is in one qubit, you can get the answer 1, 2, or infinity, depending on what exactly you mean by it. You know, I don't know how to, you know, if someone has a way to get some other answer, like 3 or 17, I'd be very interested. But, yeah. Yeah, right. Yeah. Sure. So this is the type of question, you know, that one asks, right? Like, you know, given two quantum states, like, what is the maximum probability with which you can distinguish them, right? Can say nothing is ever surprising once you understand it. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So in my brief remaining time, let me, you know, I'm now ready to tell you about quantum computing. Okay. So you know, I've already sort of, you know, given you, you know, most of what you need to understand it. So the starting observation of quantum computing is this. Let's say that we have now not, you know, 1 or 2 or 3 qubits, but we have, say, 1,000 qubits, okay? Or let's just make it n qubits, okay? Then, you know, what is the most general configuration that n qubits could be in? Here we have to, you know, again, you know, but just by the rules of quantum mechanics, we have to say that each possibility can have its own amplitude. Okay, well, in this case, there are 2 to the n possibilities, right, for assignments to an n-bit string. Okay, and so the general state of n qubits should be a superposition over all of those possibilities. Okay, you know, once again, satisfying the normalization condition. Okay, and, you know, people actually knew this since the, you know, the very beginning of quantum mechanics. I mean, a Schrodinger remarked on this in 1926, right? And he was very blasé about it. He said, you know, this supposition, you know, may seem incredible, but I don't see any other way to get the probabilities to sum up to 1. Okay, so, you know, but it was really not until a few decades ago that sort of the, you know, the enormity of sort of this, you know, statement sort of started to dawn on people, okay? Because, you know, what it's really saying is that just to keep track of the state of, let's say, 1,000 interacting particles, you know, nature off to the side somewhere, you know, has to be, you know, you could imagine, you know, writing down 2 to the 1,000th power complex numbers, you know, and then updating, you know, those numbers whenever anything happens to the qubits, right? And, you know, that's 2 to the 1,000th, of course, is, you know, more than the number of subatomic particles in the visible universe. Okay, so, I mean, this just seems like a lot of work for nature to be going to. Okay, you know, and that's really, you know, that's really staggering if sort of that, you know, if sort of that much is going on, you know. I mean, you know, of course, you know, we knew that sort of, you know, for the, that more is going on in, you know, in microscopic things than meets the eye, right? You know, anyone can verify that by looking through a microscope. Okay, but this much more, you know, it just seems exponentially more. It just seems like a completely different kind of thing. Maybe the first people to come up against this fact were, you know, the chemists and physicists who faced the practical problem of how do you simulate quantum mechanics using a conventional computer. Okay, so, you know, if you want to calculate, you know, the spectrum of a complicated atom, if you want to predict how, you know, a molecule, you know, is going to behave, how a protein is going to fold, you want to understand, the structure of a proton or a neutron, you know, how the quarks and gluons are interacting with each other. Okay, for any of these problems, you have what I would call sort of a system of a very large number of interacting qubits. The problem is that it seems that if you want to simulate that system on a classical computer, well then, yes, you can do it, but you need to keep track of a number of complex numbers, you know, up to some finite precision, say, which is not that important. You know, we can always round things to finite precision, okay? But the problematic part is just that the sheer number of these complex numbers is growing exponentially with the number of qubits. Okay, and so chemists, you know, ran up again and again against this problem. In fact, to this day, sort of, I think a significant fraction of all of the high performance computing in the world is used, you know, essentially for trying to simulate quantum mechanics. Okay, for trying to, you know, solve the Schrodinger equation, which is just sort of the continuous time version of unitary evolution. For various interesting physical systems. Great. So over the decades, you know, chemists and physicists have invented all sorts of sort of tricks and, you know, approximations and heuristics for cutting down on this exponentiality, okay, and dealing with this issue. You know, and so Nobel Prizes have been awarded for, you know, for the most successful such ways, like the density functional theory. But it's a very striking fact if we sort of cannot solve this problem in full generality. This would say that sort of nature actually requires exponential resources to simulate, you know, using any of our existing digital computers. Okay, it's sort of amazing that it took as long as it did for people to sort of, you know, ask that question, you know, crisply. But, you know, in the 1980s, people finally started asking it. So one of the first was Richard Feynman. In a now famous lecture in 1982, he pointed out this issue of exponentiality. And then, you know, he proposed an idea, which is, well, why don't we build computers that themselves, you know, take advantage of the same principles of, you know, superposition, interference, entanglement, and so forth. Okay, and then a question arises, supposing we could build those computers, what would they be good for? Well, Feynman was only able to suggest one thing that they would be good for, and that's simulating quantum physics. Okay? That sounds pretty obvious, you know, but in fact, you know, my opinion is that if we ever get practical quantum computers, that will actually still be the most important real application for them. Okay, because that is sort of what a quantum computer does natively, right? That's what it sort of does in its sleep, right? And, and furthermore, it, as I mentioned, it is a very huge practical problem, you know, that has lots and lots of real applications. So I think that certainly that's sort of the earliest and, you know, and probably the most important thing that quantum computers would be good for. Okay, but you could say to a classical computer scientist, you know, this is a little unsatisfying, right? You know, you're just solving a problem that you yourself made up. Well, you didn't make it up, nature made it up, right? But, you know, computer scientists, you know, tend to think that, you know, we should be able to decide, you know, a priori, sitting in our armchair, what are the important computational problems, okay? And so, you know, so sort of in parallel to all of this, right, there was, the theory of computational complexity, you know, was being developed. So, So we have, you know, these classes P, NP, you know, I'll assume that most of you have seen this sort of thing before. P space. Okay, that sort of capture, you know, what you can compute with different sorts of resources. And, you know, we would like, you know, and so for decades, sort of computer scientists, you know, took as their model for, you know, or their definition, if you like, of what is efficiently computable, that it's in this class P, or polynomial time, okay, which basically means that there is an algorithm running on a deterministic digital computer, you know, like the one on your desk, or, you know, or we could say mathematically, a Turing machine, okay, which solves your problem using a number of steps that grows at most like a polynomial function of the length of the input, okay? So this was our criterion for efficiency. And, you know, the amazing fact was that there were all sorts of different models of computation that led to the same complexity class P. Okay, so now what we'd really like to know is, you know, how, if at all, does quantum mechanics affect this? Okay, you know, does it require us to go, you know, does it let us do things that are outside this class P? And if so, exactly which things? Okay, so how much more time? I'll just take like 10 more minutes and then I'll open for questions. Okay. Yeah, okay, good. So, all right, so let me just be slightly more precise about what a quantum computer is. So basically it's a system where you have, you know, a whole bunch of interacting qubits. Okay, we assume for simplicity that the qubits all start out in, let's say, the zero state. Okay, and there could be n of these qubits. Let's say, you know, you receive some input, x, which is some n-bit string. Okay, so ultimately you're trying to solve some problem. Okay, you know, no matter what your computer is, right? You know, at the end, you know, what's the point of talking about it if you don't have a problem that you're trying to solve, right? So, you know, you have some string, you want to decide something about it. Is it in some language L? Okay, this could be, for example, is X interpreted as an integer, prime, or composite? Or it could be, does X interpreted as a graph have a Hamilton cycle or not? Okay, so, you know, there's some mathematical question which you're trying to answer. And so to do that, you can use a number of qubits we'll stipulate, which is any polynomial function of n, okay, of the size of your input. Okay, but now we have to answer another question, which is what kinds of unitary transformations can you apply? Okay, you know, it can't be sort of anything whatsoever, right? Because that would be like, just think about in classical computing, right? If I was drawing a circuit diagram, right, what can I put in it? I mean, So in classical computer science, right, I can have AND gates, OR gates, NOT gates. Okay, and, you know, of course, what physically justifies this is that I actually, you know, we actually know how to implement these gates using transistors, for example. You know, I could even have, let's say, an AND. I could draw an AND of a whole bunch of inputs. Okay, because, you know, I know how to do that. I know how to decompose that AND into, you know, first I AND the first two bits, and then I AND the result with the third bit, and then I AND the result of that with the fourth bit, and so forth. Okay, but, you know, could I just plunk down in my circuit, okay, and here is a box which solves the halting problem, right? Or here is a box which solves the traveling salesman problem. Okay, that's, you know, that's just not very good microprocessor design, right? Because then the engineers will come back to me and say, well, how exactly do we build this box? And I'll say, I have no idea. Okay, so in classical computer science, if you're going to build up a complicated circuit, you better build it up out of a bunch of local interactions, okay, which we could take to mean sort of AND and OR and NOT gates, for example, that act on only one or two bits at a time. Okay, and that's a good choice because AND, OR, and NOT, as many of you probably know, is a universal set of gates. Okay, so by composing enough of them, you can get any Boolean function that you like. Okay, and so, on the other hand, you know, we don't want to assume that you can have as many as you like. And, you know, in classical computer science, mostly what we're interested in is sort of what functions can you get using only a reasonable number of these locally acting AND, OR, and NOT gates. Okay, so. So we're interested in sort of what can you do with a number of these gates that grows only as some polynomial function of the size of your input. The way that you sort of formally define what is a quantum computer is almost exactly like this, except that, you know, instead of AND and OR and NOT gates, now we have quantum gates, which are just unitary transformations that act only on one or two qubits at a time. Okay? And we are allowed to have any polynomial number of such local operations in our quantum circuit. So, you know, the way that quantum circuits are drawn, is like this, where time is going from left to right, and then as time goes on, I can apply different gates. So I could apply a Hadamard gate to this qubit, maybe a pi over 8 rotation over to this one. I can do a controlled knot. This is how a controlled knot is drawn, or the C knot gate. Okay, from one control qubit to some other target qubit. Okay, and I can have a whole sequence of these of such operations as long as each operation can only act on one or two qubits at a time. It has to act as the identity transformation on all of the other qubits. Okay, and this is sort of modeling the fact that, you know, the laws of physics are local, right? They only involve interactions between pairs of particles, right? There's no law of physics that sort of, you know, just interacts, you know, 10,000 particles, you know, with it, you know, in a way that's not broken down into little, you know, local interactions. Okay, so, you know, we can do a sequence of these local interactions, a polynomial sequence of them, and then at the end, we can measure one of our qubits, which I'll call, you know, our answer qubit, in order to get, you know, say, I'll assume for simplicity that we're talking about a decision problem, so the answer is either yes or no, and then, you know, if I measure this qubit and I get a 1, then I'll accept, and if I measure this qubit and I get a 0, then I'll reject. Okay, so that's basically how a quantum computation would work. A very nice fact is that just like the AND, OR, and NOT gates are a universal set, it's also very easy to get universal sets of quantum gates, which let you sort of, in this case, approximate any unitary transformation that you like to any desired precision. Okay, and an example of a universal set would be the controlled NOT gate plus, well, pretty much any one qubit operation other than the Hadamard. Okay, Hadamard, very interestingly, doesn't work. Okay, but you could do like 3/5, 4/5, 4/5, minus 3/5. Okay, and these two will be universal except with one caveat. These will give you any, by composing enough of these, it's known that you can get arbitrarily close to any unitary transformation involving real numbers only. If you want complex numbers, of course, you need some gate involving complex numbers. Okay, but so that's basically what a quantum circuit looks like. You know, and then the one final sort of technical requirement is that you have to be able to describe to your classical computer how to apply the quantum circuit. Okay, so in other words, there has to be a classical algorithm that efficiently outputs a description of what quantum circuit should be applied. Okay, and this is called uniformity. And so you put all of these requirements together, and you get another complexity class, which was defined by Bernstein and Vazirani in 1993. And this class is called BQP, okay, for bounded error quantum polynomial time. Okay, so this is basically the class of problems that, you know, can be efficiently solved solved in polynomial time using a quantum computer. Okay, the B stands for bounded error. Okay, and so this is saying that, well, look, you know, the quantum computer only has to get the right answer with some probability, which is noticeably greater than a half. Okay, why is that? Well, because let's say it gets the right answer 60% of the time. Well, then if I wanted to be very, very confident of the answer, I would just repeat my computation 1,000 times, and I would take the majority vote. Okay, so I can always amplify, you know, just like with classical randomized algorithms. Okay, so now the question is, you know, just how big is this class? So, now we can sort of state, you know, what, like, the way that the popular articles normally misdescribe quantum computers as sort of a formal question, right? We can ask the question, can a quantum computer solve NP complete problems in polynomial time? Or in other words, is NP a subset of BQP? Okay, and you know, many people's intuition for how a quantum computer works, you know, would say that the answer to that should be yes, because after all, you can, you know, with quantum mechanics, you can go into a superposition over all the possible solutions to, you know, your favorite combinatorial problem. Right, so if you had a satisfiability problem, for example, you could generate an equal superposition over all 2 to the n possible satisfying assignments. Okay, the problem, once again, it comes back to this question of how do you actually extract the information that you want by making a measurement. Okay, and here the problem should be obvious. Okay, that, you know, if I just measure this state in the standard way, all I'm going to get is a random answer, right? Each one with probability, each string with probability 1/2 to the n. Okay, but if I just wanted a random answer, well, I could have picked one myself. I could have saved the $15 million on the quantum computer, you know, and just, you know, stayed home and flipped a coin. Okay, so, you know, so this raises an important point that, you know, quantum computing is only interesting if it gives you any advantage over and above what you could get by just a classical probabilistic algorithm. Okay, and the only thing that makes quantum mechanics different from classical probability theory is that it involves these amplitudes, which are complex numbers, and which can interfere with each other. Okay, so all of the quantum algorithms we know, all of the ways that we know, you know, for using a quantum computer to get any kind of advantage over a classical computer involve very, very cleverly setting up patterns of quantum interference, okay, which have the property that, you know, among all of the different paths that lead to each given wrong answer, some of those paths have positive amplitude, others have negative amplitude, and as a result, they can't, you know, mostly cancel each other out. Okay, whereas the paths that lead to a given right answer sort of reinforce each other, right? And they all have amplitudes sort of the same sign. Okay, and so then, you know, if you can arrange that to happen, then when you measure your quantum computer at the end, then a right answer will be observed with very high probability. Okay, but now, you know, you can see that this is a much more subtle kind of thing than what the popular articles usually describe. You know, and it's only for a few very special problems that we know how to do this to actually solve something faster than, you know, than we know how to solve it classically. Okay, so the most famous example um, is factoring integers, okay, and other related things like discrete logarithms. So Peter Shor, almost 20 years ago, discovered a way by using a polynomial-sized quantum circuit that you can input a giant number, let's say, you know, an n-digit number, and you can get as output with high probability the prime factors of that number when you measure. Okay, basically by arranging a very, very clever interference pattern. I wish I had time to tell you how it works, but I don't. But, you know, but now a very important point to make is that factoring is neither known, you know, nor believed to be an NP-complete problem. Okay, so factoring, you know, yes, we don't know how to solve it classically, and, you know, it seems hard. It's, you know, hard enough that we, for better or worse, we base the security of all of our electronic commerce on, you know, on our belief that this problem is hard. But, you know, it's thought to be somewhere intermediate between P and NP complete. Okay, so here's P, here's NP, here's the NP complete problems. Those are the ones at the top, the hardest problems in NP, right? Factoring seems like it's, you know, somewhere in the middle here, okay. Hard but not NP hard. And now this, okay, so in addition to polynomial time, there's probabilistic polynomial time, so we can just have classical randomized algorithms. Most theorists today actually conjecture that BPP is equal to P, okay, so that every randomized algorithm can be simulated deterministically. Okay, this would be true if, as long as we had good enough pseudo-random number generators, essentially. Okay, so let me just say, I'll just, you know, BPP is more or less equal to P. Okay, but then BQP, this quantum class, seems, you know, very interestingly larger, or at least, you know, it contains the factoring problem. Okay, very importantly, no one knows whether BQP contains all of NP. Okay, so we don't know if you can solve NP-complete problems in polynomial time with a quantum computer. Most of us conjecture that the answer is no. Okay, more or less the same grounds that we think that you can't do it with a classical computer. Okay, because we don't know how. Right, you know, now of course, you know, we can't prove that quantum computers can't solve NP-complete problems with our present knowledge. Why not? Well, we can't even prove that classical computers can't solve them. That's the P versus NP problem, which maybe you've heard of. Okay, but, you know, doesn't seem like it. Now, on the other side, we also know that BQP is contained in P space. So it can be simulated by a classical computer using a polynomial amount of memory, but possibly using exponential time. Okay, so this is roughly where, you know, BQP sort of fits into the hierarchy of, you know, of theoretical computer science, or where quantum computing fits in. Okay, and so one very important consequence that we can draw from this is that, so if you like, you know, like a central question of quantum computing theory is, you know, quantum polynomial time really a larger class than classical randomized polynomial time, right? We also know that you can certainly simulate a classical computer using a quantum computer. I don't know why you would want to, but you can. Okay, so, but the question is, can you do even more quantumly than you can do classically? And, you know, and so we think so because, you know, we know that you can do factoring, and we don't think you can do factoring with a classical computer, but of course no one has proved that. Okay, and in fact we can see just from this picture that if you wanted to prove that quantum computers were more powerful than classical computers, okay, that BQP is a proper, properly contains BPP, then you would also have to prove that P space properly contains P. Okay, you know, if you separate these two, right, then you also separate these two. Okay, but P versus P space is yet another famous unsolved problem, you know, considered to be essentially as hard as the P versus NP problem. Okay, so this is telling us that in our present state of knowledge, we cannot hope to sort of prove unconditionally that quantum computers can do more in polynomial time than classical computers. Okay, it just remains, you know, a very, very plausible conjecture. So a lot of research, you know, about quantum algorithms actually involves considering very simple types of algorithms that are sort of only able to sort of look at the input as a black box, and then you ask questions like, how many accesses do you need to this black box in order to learn something that you want? Okay, and there, you know, there's some very important discoveries like Grover's algorithm, okay, that say, you know, if you have a list, any kind of list of n possibilities, then quantum mechanically you can search through that list using only about square root of n steps. Okay, so what that says is that for NP complete problems, you know, you can't get, you know, or we don't know how to get an exponential speed up using a quantum computer, but it does seem plausible that at least you could get a polynomial speed up, like a square root speed up, you know. Instead of 2 to the n steps, you know, quantumly, you merely need 2 to the n over 2 steps. Okay, still exponential, but, you know, it's a little bit better of an exponential. Now, the reason I say that this is only a plausible speed up is that, you know, many of you might know that when dealing with NP-complete problems in the real world, you know, you never use brute force search, even in the classical case, right? You always use sort of backtracking or simulated annealing or other kinds of clever heuristics. Okay, and it remains a very big sort of research question whether sort of adding Grover's algorithm into the mix or adding other sort of quantum tricks into the mix, you know, can give you an additional advantage in solving NP-complete problems over and above, you know, what these all these classical tricks and heuristics already give you. Okay, you know, you might get an additional advantage, but we don't really know yet. You know, D-Wave's whole business plan is, you know, based on, you know, the hypothesis that you will get an advantage. And, you know, I wish them success. You know, I really do. But, you know, what I keep trying to explain to the journalists who ask me is that, you know, this remains, you know, like many other things in this field, it remains a big open question whether you can get an advantage here. So I'll open the floor to questions at this point. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, sorry, can you speak louder? Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right, so, okay. So the answer to the second question is simply that RSA would be broken. So first, you know, let me be concrete about just, you know, just how fast you could do the things. So first of all, what is the best known classical algorithm for factoring? So the best known classical algorithm is called the number field sieve. You know, it's actually a lot better than just a naive brute force search. And it searches, and it's able to factor an n-digit number in something like exponential in cube root of n steps, okay? Which is, you know, much better than exponential in n steps, right? So this is already, I'll put it out here, this is already what you can do classically, okay? But this has been used to, I think, you know, factor, you know, well, certainly, you know, 128-bit, you know, I think even, you know, 128, like, decimal-digit numbers. Okay, quantumly, we have Shor's algorithm. And Shor's algorithm actually, you know, needs only about n squared steps. Okay, maybe n squared log n or something. You know, it depends if you're parallelizing it, you know, you can do even better. In fact, if you parallelize it, you can do it, you know, within only logarithmic quantum parallel time plus polynomial classical post-processing time. Okay, so, you know, in any case, it's quite efficient. And certainly, you know, if you can implement this scalably, it's certainly efficient enough to render RSA, you know, an insecure crypto system. Okay, so you might wonder just, you know, just how bad would the damage be? So, okay, RSA would be broken. By using related quantum algorithms, you could also break Diffie-Hellman. Elliptic curve cryptography would also be broken. You know, the basically any cryptography that's based on abelian groups would be broken, is the rule. Shor's algorithm lets you sort of find out anything you might want to know about an abelian group in polynomial time. Okay. However, an often unappreciated point is that there are public key cryptosystems out there today that we don't know how to break efficiently, even with a quantum computer. Okay. And so the most important class of such cryptosystems is the lattice-based cryptosystems. Okay. And for these, you know, the underlying problem you have to solve involves non-abelian groups. And people have been trying to find quantum algorithms to break these systems for, you know, more than a decade. Okay, and they haven't. And, you know, these systems are, you know, they're not as practical as RSA because they require sort of large key sizes and large message sizes. Okay, but they're attracting more and more interest these days. You know, one reason is that they're, you know, they seem resistant even to quantum attack. A second reason is that just 4 years ago, Craig Gentry discovered that you can use lattice-based cryptography to do what's called fully homomorphic encryption. You can do arbitrary computations on encrypted data without ever having to decrypt the data. Okay, so lattice-based crypto has, you know, several remarkable properties. I think that if we ever get practical quantum computers, then, you know, it's quite possible that we'll all just switch over to lattice-based cryptography, okay? Or we could also switch over to quantum crypto, okay? You know, we'd have two pretty good choices. So, you know, so this is a reason why I think that Shor's algorithm, as dramatic as it was, is actually not at all the most important practical implication if we get quantum computers. I would say the most important practical implication would probably be quantum simulation. You know, and maybe to a lesser extent, these sort of modest speed ups that you could get for NP-hard optimization problems. Anyone else? Yeah. What? I don't understand what you mean. Well, okay, so okay, right. So, okay, all right. I think I understand what's being asked. So you can ask, you know, I mean, it's an interesting observation, right, that the, you know, there's an enormous number of possible quantum states on n qubits, right? In fact, the number is not merely exponential in n, it's doubly exponential in n. Okay, of course, the real answer is there's infinitely many. But I mean, even if you truncated the amplitudes to some finite precision, right, there would still be, to specify each state takes like, you know, would take an exponential number of bits, right? And so there's a double exponential number of possibilities, okay? However, only a tiny, out of all the sort of mathematically possible quantum states, it's actually, you know, on n qubits, it's really only a tiny fraction of them that could ever be realistically prepared. Okay, and the reason is that if you consider how many quantum circuits are there with, let's say, n squared gates or some polynomial number of gates, well, the number of such circuits is only singly exponential in n. Okay, so in some sense, you know, even though this, you know, mathematically, this, you know, space of n qubit states is this vast, you know, unbelievably vast sort of configuration space, it's only a tiny fraction of that space that quantum computers could ever sort of realistically explore, you know, using polynomial resources, right? And so some, you know, again and again, I've met people who know sort of a little bit about the field, but sort of not enough, and they think, aha, this proves quantum computing. This shows that, you know, because you can't get to arbitrary quantum states, okay? And the answer to that, of course, is that getting to arbitrary quantum states was never, you know, what anyone claimed is the point of quantum computing, right? The point is just to solve, you know, particular problems like factoring integers or, you know, simulating quantum dynamics. Okay, and you know, for these problems, we know, you know, it's been proved that the, you know, the small fraction of states that we can actually get to are enough to let us solve those problems in polynomial time.